Hello, thank you. Thank you for joining us. We're going to get in just one moment to Ruth and Chaya, who are going to take us on a journey that is a little bit different from how these discussions usually happen, into the real kishkes of the guts of Israeli religion and state, religion and society debates. I would like, before turning to them to get real knowledge, I would like to set the stage in just one observation. Ladies and gentlemen, Israelis are exotic. They are very profoundly strange. And we have to get into this debate with that assumption. The people sitting in this room are by and large Americans. Some of you might be Canadians. If I missed anyone else, I got the two important ones. So, and the important thing is to grasp that this in Israel, this is a debate among Israelis that has fundamentally different assumptions. Thomas Jefferson died July 4th, 1826, 50 years to the day after the signing of the Declaration of Independence. Thomas Jefferson, on his tombstone, asked that several of his titles and achievements be put on his tombstone. One of them was that he was the author of the Declaration of Independence. That he was president of the United States did not make it onto the tombstone. But what did make it onto the tombstone was that he is the man who essentially privatized the state church of Virginia. The separation of church and state in the United States of America was one of the great projects for the redemption of humanity in the eyes of the founding fathers, who thought they had just redeemed humanity. And now you just hit the button and the whole thing happens on autopilot. A couple civil wars later, et cetera, whatever. A Donald Trump election, Hillary, yeah, Democrats. Basically, the whole world's about to be redeemed. Ladies and gentlemen, in America, when you want to separate church and state, you want to do it because you have a deep and abiding and passionate love for religion. I don't know about you personally, but that was the theory behind the separation of church and state. So a person running for president, maybe this is changing, could not get elected unless God was blessing America in every speech. You will not elect a religious people. Gallup has a poll of Americans from about 4 or 5 months ago trying to find out the place of minorities in the American public consciousness, especially in this very fraud election. Atheists, ladies and gentlemen, are the only religious group below Muslims in American public opinion. Which Americans in this room are like, yeah, I mean, you know, who among us hasn't been an atheist on one Tuesday in July, right? But I get why, right? But if you go to Israel or you step outside of the borders of American culture, an atheist is worse than a Muslim when you're in a culture war, or you think you're in a culture war with Muslims? What is happening to Americans? And the answer is that in America, you separate religion and state because you love religion and you fear the state. The highest aspiration of a person's life is a religious one. And politics is the art of prostituting ideals in order to get things done. And religion shouldn't be in that den of iniquity and prostitution that the founding fathers viewed as Congress, and I think we share those views today. There's a different view, and I'm going to sum up with a different view of the question of religion and state. And in France, they don't talk about the separation of church and state, which is to say the institutions of religion should be free from the institutions of the state so that religion itself, the pure thing, can pervade public discourse. Someone who doesn't fear God doesn't fear sin, and we can't trust him to run the country. In France, they talk about the separation of religion et état, religion and state. Because the French revolutionaries were very different people from the American revolutionaries, and for many long periods in the French Republic, the French solution to religion was, you know, an opiate of the masses, a corrupt thing. The French experience with the church was that it was part of the king's ancien regime, that was part of the oppressive mechanisms against the people. and therefore the state controls the church. I really am finishing this sentence. Takes control of the church, pays the priest's salaries, and like heroin that you want to keep out of schools, but morphine that you want to make accessible to hospitals, like a drug, you hold religion tight through money, and you prevent it from taking over the public square and polluting it. And the best human, of course, is the rational atheist. Israel, in that spectrum of options between the United States and the French, and it's a lot more complex, we're just laying out options, is much, much closer to France. Secular Israel agreed to give the rabbinate its power so that they can pay the rabbinate's salary, so that they can control the rabbinate, and there's a fight over how much religion gets into the public space. And if you talk about a religious prime minister, you set a lot of Israelis' hearts aflutter.
I'm just going to yell it.
Can you hear me? Can you hear? Okay. So, welcome to Israel. Welcome to a world that doesn't know religion is a good thing in political terms. Welcome to a world that doesn't talk about church and state, but religion and state and its place. And a world where the state institutions of religion are being fought over by the people who want to control the public square one way or the other. I'm going to hand the microphone over to Ruth Halperin Kaddari, professor. Who will introduce herself, give you some background, and then Chaya Gilboa, who will introduce herself, give you some background, and then I will just ask a couple of questions for the rest of this time, and we're going to try and get into the minds of Israelis, the problems, and hopefully look at it in angles that are a little deeper than is possible, in 800-word articles or protests or things like that, that we do maybe have access to. So let's get started.
Thank you. Thank you very much. First of all, thank you very much, Susie, and thank you very much to Einat Horowitz, the director of IREP in Israel, for inviting me, for having me over here. It's really a privilege to be able to address and talk about the issues that are so close to my heart. And thank you, Haviv, for the introduction and for some very good quotes, which I'm going to write up and remember and use in the future. So just a few sentences about where I come from and what made me come here today. I grew up in the regular Tzionut Datit house, probably closer to the historical Mafdal, which unfortunately is no longer on the Israeli political map. But I'm a product of the traditional stream of national religious education in Israel. I went to the army. My first degree in law was from Bar-Ilan Faculty of Law. But my formative experience came when I had the privilege of studying at Yale Law School, where my master's and my doctorate is. During those years, I experienced both the exposure to feminism and feminist ideas and feminist critique of law, which was not to be heard of when I studied law in Israel, but also the experience of the richness of Jewish way of life under religious pluralism. And realizing that there is more than one way to worship and to be part of the Jewish tradition and the Jewish experience, including being a religious feminist, even an Orthodox feminist. And I would never forget the first time that I had Aliyah on Simchat Torah in Westville Synagogue with my one-year-old son on my hands when I was about 22 years old. That was the first time that I could actually see a Sefer Torah, what it looked like from inside. So my daughter had already had her bat mitzvah and read from the Torah at the Kotel on Robinson's Arch, which is which is something that we're going to talk about in the next hour, I believe. So this was really my formative experience, and when I came back to Israel, I knew that I would enter this field of teaching, the area which is the most problematic for women's rights in Israel, and where the Gordian knot of religion and state is so hard to tackle, which is family law in Israel. And I also knew that I was believing not just in the possibility of a woman teaching and writing in family law in Israel, which is governed mostly by religious law, by Jewish law, for Jews, and by Sharia law, and by canon law for non-Jews, but so not only to prove that, but also I believed very much in the responsibility of academia in for society, and believing in law as a tool for social change. I knew that this is what I want to do, and not be a regular professor, you know, sitting on the Ivy Tower, but utilizing my professional experience to create social change in reality, in real life. And the opportunity indeed came when the late Rabbi Professor Reckman, with whom I also had the privilege of actually studying. He was also a law professor at Bar-Ilan University long, long, long time ago. And for his 90th birthday, there was a major fundraising. And he said that he wanted those funds to go to the Bar-Ilan Faculty of Law to establish a center for the advancement of women's rights within Judaism and within Jewish law, and he actually said that he wanted me to run this center. I was very young at that, in my professional career at that time, and fortunately I got this wonderful opportunity. At the same time, I was also nominated by Israeli Ministry of Foreign Affairs to run for the committee, the United Nations Committee on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women. It's the committee that oversees the implementation of what's known as the Women's Convention in the UN. And indeed, I was elected then. I was then re-elected three times. It's my 10th year now on this committee. And this also allows me a very, very broad perspective of women's situations worldwide, and not just in Israel, including all these issues of religion and state, and how very, very sadly religion today is one of the strongest powers that impede on the advancement of women's rights universally, globally. And unfortunately, Israel is no exception for that, and it really doesn't have to be that way. So that's why I'm here for. Thank you.
Tada, Ruth. So maybe I'll start, and I say that what I do today is very much related to education. I work for the Hartman Institute in Jerusalem. I ran a program that it's a gap year in Mechina for Israelis and Americans who comes together to live together for 9 months to study, to do some community service. And what I do, like when I'm not there and when I'm not trying to raise my son, is I'm very much involved in activism in Jerusalem, especially in things that related to religion and states. Maybe as Ruth started, I will share with you, I come from Har Nof, which is in Jerusalem. It's a, let's say, ultra-Orthodox community. My dad is considering himself part of this Haredi world. If you will see him, he got all the accessories, he looks completely Haredi. My mom is I think, similar to Ruth's family, is more like Tzioni Dati, but very, very religious. And I remember myself growing up in this neighborhood, I always had a hard time. And I think everyone asked me always, when did you come out of the Jewish closet? And there is no like a specific time, but I always felt like I want to be an active player, thank you, in the Jewish field. And I always felt like I have to be very passive. And it's not only when you come on Shabbat and you see this, it's not a mechitza. For me, it was a real wall. But I always felt that I have so many questions, and I want to really be part of this thing that called Judaism. And I always was forced to be silent and quiet and on the side. And I think when, part of me felt that I need to leave the neighborhood in order to come back different. And it took me some years. And after my service, I went and I decided to study Talmud in the university. And I remember coming to my dad and I told him, Abba, I need some help, like financially, you need to support me to pay for school. And he said, really, Chaya, study everything, be'emet everything, study Buddhism, study Islam, but don't study Talmud in the university. And I think he realized something that it took me a while to understand when I arrived to the university, that of course the way that the academia looks on those materials, it's from a critical perspective. So not only women are not supposed to study philosophy, we're the one who's supposed to run the kitchen, the house, but we also, it's not our space, we're a guest in this space. But it was unbelievable 3 years, not only academically, but really spiritually. And I think it's really helped me to come back home different. And for me, something that happened in these 3 years, I started working for the Jewish agency. I was Israel fellow in Russia and Ukraine. And I think today, if you ask me what really formed my Jewish identity, was being outside of Israel and coming back, but being outside of Israel. And after those 3 years, I went for 2 years to Berkeley. I was the Israel fellow on campus. Was tremendous. It was unbelievable 2 years, especially around the BDS question. And I think I was very lefty. And I remember telling to the committee in the Jewish agency who wanted to send me, I said to them, find the most lefty place in the world. And then I got to Berkeley and I felt like Lieberman because it was like beyond left. But it was so not only about the Israel issues, but I took classes with Professor Daniel Boyar in Talmud and with Judith Butler, not with. Like it was like 200 people in the class, but on gender. And it blew my mind. And I remember that once Daniel Boyarin spoke about one of the sugiyot in the Talmud about divorce. And he spoke about it like an intellectual exercise. And he spoke about things that happened like 1,000 years ago and more. And I sat there in the class and I said to myself, it's not an intellectual exercise. It's the real life of people in Israel that literally taking those texts and implement that in the public space in Israel. So I went back and I went to the Hebrew University and I did my master in public policy. And what I did is what all the matalot, like all the papers that we needed to write, the assignments, I dedicated to the question of religion and state. So I tried to create an alternative for civil marriage and for conversion. And one of the things that I tried to do is really to, I was very busy with the kashrut thing, and I end up taking one of my assignment, and now it's a project that I will maybe share a little bit more. I end up writing my thesis about Haredi women and how they became a change agent in Israel. It's amazing if you hear my, I interviewed them and I recorded it, and I literally, half of the time crying because I look at them and most of them are from Harnof and I think to myself, like, what if I could, like, my life could have been like this kind of story. And I think I'm aware that I'm very privileged in that sense, that that I was able to leave that neighborhood but still to stay. And I think maybe I'll close and I say that my motivation, everything I do that related to religion and state, I'm not coming from a secular perspective, even so today I'm not religious. But I don't think we need to separate religion and state. I think the Jewish part in the Israeli state needs to be much more pluralistic, but it needs to be Jewish. I don't want to live in I don't want to live in a country that is only democratic, that it doesn't have any Jewish thing in the public domain. I want it to be Jewish. But I think the Jewish must be democratic. So everything that I do today, and I'm very much involved in civil marriage and conversion and the kashrut, and what I want to bring to the table is my love to Jewish life and tradition. But I think the equality and the pluralism must be the guide for those things. So I guess I will expand on this. So
I want to start, Professor Kaddari, with the devil's advocate position. Under law, it is true that Jews can't marry outside the rabbinate. Muslims have to marry in the Sharia court system paid by the state of Israel, which is a strange thing in Western democracies. Catholics, etc. However, we have an institution called Yiduim B'Tzibur, recognized by courts, essentially a common law marriage, which applies to anybody, including same-sex couples. we have protections up until adoption for same-sex couples through that institution. People can fly to Cyprus and get married in 10 minutes and $50 fee. And when they go to Cyprus, they meet Lebanese couples who are trying to escape exactly the same Ottoman institutions that they haven't been able to take apart there too. So Israelis aren't actually failing to marry. And so my question is, what is actually missing? What is the crisis? What is the problem? What bothers us so much when there are all these workarounds in Israeli society?
So you pointed to one of the biggest paradoxes in Israel, because on the one hand, we have the most progressive institute of, sometimes it's referred to as de facto marriages or cohabitation, or in Hebrew we say yeduim betzibur, the situation where a couple lives together without marriage, and they are being recognized by the Israeli state and by the legal system as if they were married. So their status is equal in every respect except for the registration. They are not registered as married. And this is way, way more progressive, quote unquote, than any other equivalent situation elsewhere in the world, where you may have registered partnerships, but just couples who live together very often are not being recognized by the state. And so, for example, economic rights of women, if they separate after 15 years together and maybe even raising children together, their economic rights are not protected. And in Israel, they are. So it's kind of a paradox, because on the other hand, we have such restrictive regime of marriage where a Jew can only marry Jew, Muslim can only marry Muslim. There are all those marital prohibitions within Jewish law. A Kohen cannot marry a divorcee, and so on and so forth. But it's not a paradox. It's because the secular system invented this bypass, this subterfuge to the restrictive marriage regime that this situation can still be maintained. And like you pointed out, the fact that people can fly to Cyprus or take a cruise, it's a huge tasya industry of marriage industry of honeymoon cruises to Cyprus and get married along the way. So this also allows maintaining this blatant violation of human rights, because first and foremost, it is the harshest violation of human rights of the state of Israel that a person cannot marry within the state. Cannot get married within the state. There are hundreds of thousands of people who are not affiliated, who are not religiously affiliated because they are not recognized as Jews by the state of Israel, mostly coming from former Soviet Union, but not only from there, and they simply cannot marry within Israel. There are couples who want to get married, interfaith marriages, they cannot marry in Israel. There are very large group of people who cannot divorce in Israel, and I'll get to that in a minute. Those who cannot divorce but are separated for years and years, they cannot open a new page. They cannot get married again in Israel. So you have all these categories of people whose most elementary human right within the most sensitive and the most intimate identity, self-identity, whose rights are being violated on a daily basis in Israel. So even if we have these practical solutions, this is not what a Western democracy should look like. We're the only country in the industrialized world, or in the UN, we don't say Western world. We say industrialized or developed countries, or maybe the northern part of the globe. We're the only country in that part where we consider ourselves democracy, but with all due respect, and I say it with great sorrow, we are not democratic in that sense. We are part of the geographical area in which we are situated in the Middle East. And we women, whose rights are being most violated and most discriminated against, and this is the area where the harshest discrimination against women in Israel is, within family law, because of the inability to get divorced. Because the religious get is exclusively in the rights of the husbands. If the husband does not willingly offer his wife this religious bill of divorce, the get, then she is not free to formulate any relations with another person. If she has children with another man, these children are bastard. And this is a sanction which women, notwithstanding whether they are religious or non-religious, completely secular, women are afraid of this label. As Imam Zer, no woman whom I know in her right mind would bear a child who will born into this category of being a mamzer. And it's completely unequal because a man can have relations with another with another wife and even be recognized by the state as forming this de facto union and having all the rights and all the recognition by the state. And based on this such unequal distribution of power, this is how divorces in Israel take place. This is what the Rachman Institute, the Rachman Center, deals with on a daily basis. We represent women who are unable to get their divorces, who are being extorted on a daily basis. And I'll just end with one piece of data. A survey that we conducted at the Rachman Center a year ago showed that every third woman in Israel who is undergoing divorce proceedings is being extorted on the basis of this threat not to give her a get. And the more religious the woman is, and the less educated she is, and unfortunately sometimes it goes together, it's 50%. Every second ultra-Orthodox woman who undergoes divorce is being extorted in order to gain her very basic human rights, simply the ability to exit, to step out of an unwanted marriage. So even if we have these practical solutions, first of all, there are no solutions for everybody. And don't forget that even if you got married in Cyprus, you still have to go through the rabbinical courts if you want to divorce. And if you are a woman, you are still under the risk and under the threat of being an aguna, of being unable to divorce, even if you got only civilly married. It doesn't mean that you don't have to go through the rabbinical courts. So it's really no solution.
So I want to ask two questions, and I'll start with Chaya, and also your experience in the field of sort of finding your way around rabbinate marriages. I'm very conscious, because I'm the outsider on this panel, that you're both Orthodox. No offense, as they say. I hope that's okay that I categorize. Observant. So my question, and maybe Chaya, your experience can say something to this. But as you said, there, it's not, you know, 1,000 people who fall through the cracks of this sort of strange, unofficial equilibrium that we've found. It's hundreds of thousands of people who fall through the cracks. There are 300,000 Israelis from the former Soviet Union who are direct family members of Jews but aren't halachically Jews, and the rabbinate won't accept. They can't marry anybody. They can't marry themselves, amongst themselves, under Israeli law. Wouldn't the rabbinate be well served to fix that part? In other words, just around the edges. Give nothing in, but just around the edges. And I want to start first, Chaya, and we'll come back to you. Answer that question, but maybe answer it. You married outside the rabbinate,
yeah.
Orthodox.
So maybe Ruth is my hero, just for you to know. I'm like in a panel with my year's hero. But you end your talk and you said that there is no solution. So I do want to talk about solutions that I think exist. And I want to give some hope in this. And I think maybe sometimes coming from the field can really give you some hope that maybe people who deal a lot with like top down doesn't see. And I think maybe I'll start and I share with you that when I decided, when me and my partner decided we want to get married, we know it's not going to be through the Rabbanut, but I knew that if I want my dad and my family to be there, it must be halachically. And also I wanted it to be traditional. I didn't want to be like, to do like an alternative chuppah. This is my language. I speak Jewish before I speak Hebrew. This is what I want in my special day. So what we did, we looked for an Orthodox rabbi who will be willing to marry us. But we had two conditions. We wanted it to be completely egalitarian. And because I studied Talmud, and I think maybe it goes back to what Haviv said, I'll say something in parentheses, that in Israel, the secular community most of the time doesn't know what is halachically and what is politics. And when the Rabbanut say, in a chuppah, a woman cannot talk because this is what the halacha said, secular people will say, okay, fine, so if you want to get married in a traditional way, this is a traditional way. But it's not true, because if you will open a chuppah ceremony, you will see that in the chuppah there is many, many places that a woman can definitely take an equal part and it still be halachic. But I think this is partially why the secular community in Israel doesn't understand that they can change it and still it can be Jewish and halachic. So we decided to get married, and I literally, I went to interview, I swear, almost 20 rabbis, Orthodox, which I assume they shared my point of view of liberalism and pluralism. None of them was willing to marry me if I'm not going to register in the Rabbanut. And many of them told me, Chaya, you can give a ring, but you need to say it's a present. You cannot really say this at this part. And I said, and they agreed with me that halachically there is not a problem for the ceremony to be egalitarian. And more than that, halachically, I don't need the Rabbanut. I don't need them, of course. By the eyes of God, I'm married if there is someone who set up their wedding and there is two witnesses. But then I find one rabbi, and guess what? He's American. And I'm saying this because in all the activism that I'm part of in Jerusalem, I work a lot with my sisters abroad in North America and American rabbis, women and men. And I think because they get something, because they understand what is it to be a minority in a liberal setting, and that you can hold traditional views and pluralistic views and it can go together. So he was willing to marry us, and according to the Israeli law, he passed the law. If he was cut, his license to marry other couples will be taken from him.
Maximum sentence of 2 years in prison.
Yes, yes. And
it's never been enforced, but this actually was.
I wait for this to be enforced because one of the things is that, I think Shas wrote it, that when they do it, the couples and the rabbi will go to jail together. So I'm like waiting for this to happen. Some quiet time with my husband and the rabbi. But what was amazing that my dad almost didn't come. My dad really almost didn't come to the wedding. It was really hard for him. Because what he did in the end, that he didn't invite anyone from the Haredi family because he knew. My secular friend thought I married through the Rabbanut because they saw a rabbi. And it was almost the traditional chuppah, but egalitarian. But the Haredi family knew immediately that once women talk, of course, it didn't go through the Rabbanut. But what happened was, after the Chatuna, many of the people who came to the wedding, I start getting phone calls, tons of phone calls from people who said, listen, until today, we thought it either to do it through the Rabbanut and have a chuppah that doesn't reflect on what we believe in our regular life, or we marry completely in a secular setting, having a friend marry us. Can you help us find a rabbi that will, Orthodox rabbi, or like a rabbi that really commit to the halacha, that will perform an egalitarian chuppah without registering? So it's become my project. So what I do today, and what amazing is that I'm working a lot with like secular couples who just want the chuppah to be egalitarian. But what amazing is that I'm getting tons of phone calls from Orthodox couples, or modern Orthodox couples, that understand that they can go to the Rabbanut and register, and they're not Russian, like they didn't come from Russia, Ukraine, they don't have any problem. But they choose to live a life, egalitarian life, and they say, in my chatuna, in my chuppah, I wanted to reflect who I am. And this is amazing, I'm not Orthodox anymore, but I think the changes that now is happening in Israel in so many fields, I don't know if you will agree with me, it comes from Orthodox women. Because once someone in Tel Aviv can yell, a secular person can yell for separating religion and state, nothing gonna happen. Israel is a very traditional state. But when an Orthodox woman who is committed to halacha and say, I'm not trying to break anything, I'm just trying to pluralize the Jewish part and I wanna have my voice in it, this is much, much more effective. And I think in the wedding setting, we have more and more couples who choose today not to register at all. I'm a single mother, even so, really, my husband take care of the kids much more than I do, mamash. But I'm a single mother, even so, in the eyes of God, I'm married, because we never registered, because exactly what Ruth said, if I would have go to Cyprus and I come back, God forbid, if we decide to separate, I'll need to go to the Rabbanut to do it, and I don't want that. So I just want to say that the chuppah, it's aesthetics, right? If a woman talk or not. But the real threat, and it's a threat, is what happened when you decide to divorce. And then as a woman, you are in a big problem. So I do think that there is more and more couples today that understand that they can make their own decisions. They don't need to rely about changes that the Rabbanut might or might not do, or what the government will or will not do in the future. We can do it ourselves. And I truly believe, that if this number of couples will become like a big like community, a massive, a critic mass, yeah, I think the government will need to create some arrangement. So if it's not going to come top down, we're going to create it bottom up. And I really, really believe that can change the game.
Thank you. We have 20 minutes to cover the Kotel, conversion, and Kashrut. So you all think we're going to cut something. We're just going to talk very fast.
I do have some things to add.
After this, we're going to talk fast. We're going to cut everything. This was fascinating and amazing, not a minute wasted, but let's keep answers very short because we do want to cover especially Kotel, I think, and Kashrut.
Okay, so I couldn't agree more. I think that whoever looks at what happens within feminism in Israel, the eyes should turn to religious feminism and to what's happening within Orthodox women's organizations, even Haredi women's, the phenomenon that you describe is a demonstration of how Orthodox men can be recruited for the battle of advancing egalitarianism and equal rights within Judaism, within Jewish law, which is indeed possible. And you just mentioned before, you asked about the relationship between the limitations on the right to marry and the limitations on conversion. And there as well, I think that we are starting to see some kind of a reaction that comes from within, from the Orthodox rabbis, those who are willing to challenge the monopoly of the formal rabbinate. And we see the beginning of what call themselves as private rabbinical batei din legiur, private rabbinical courts for conversion. And it is, in fact, maybe interestingly, it comes only after the modern Orthodox or slightly modern Orthodox, or Rabbanei Tzohar, for example, or Beit Hillel, who tried to challenge the rabbinic council, tried to sort of take over, to have one of their representatives be elected to be the chief rabbi, and they failed. After this failure, they understood that there's absolutely no future within the formal institutions of the state, and they allowed themselves to make challenges from within. So I think that Chaya is right. There may be some hope in those venues.
Yeah, I just a personal thing on how widespread this phenomenon is. It's much more widespread than you think. From cherry-picked panels at the GA, where people are carefully chosen for what it is that they have to say. But I don't come from the Orthodox world. My father is a Reform rabbi and a cantankerous one who likes to tell people why they're wrong. And my wife is the daughter of an Orthodox rabbi from Baltimore, Maryland. She's the oldest of 8 kids. And her father married us in Israel. And I had this one condition that it wouldn't be through the rabbinate because I was raised on sitting on the knee of Thomas Jefferson. And so not only did he agree joyfully and gleefully, when we found out that he actually wasn't violating Israeli law because he's not a registered Israeli marriage registrar, he was very disappointed. And not only that, but I come from a little bit of a politically involved family, and there were members of Knesset at my wedding, including Orthodox ones and including Haredi ones. And they thought it was absolutely adorable. In other words, it was that they are not worried about losing the culture war, unless the camera's trained on their face, in which case, obviously, they have to fight the culture war. So at the subterranean level, The lived experience of Israelis is that there is what to win here, and it crosses very broad cross sections of Israeli society. I'm sorry, we have to move on to the Kotel, ladies and gentlemen. I don't know if you've heard, there's this place called the Western Wall in Jerusalem, being Jews, we are fighting about it. And so, I want to start with Ruth. Tell us, and then we'll move right to Chaya without going back to me. What the heck is, at this moment, the Western Wall Heritage Foundation? What is the Kotel? Why can I go to ancient sites and holy sites and sacred sites and tombs of ancient sages and all kinds of Kever Achel and just 1,000 different places where people go to pray consistently and all the time and that are ancient symbols of our Jewish whatever, and there's no mechitza, and there's no rabbi who runs the place, and I don't have to worry about whether I could take a Sefer Torah in or not take a Sefer Torah in, or whether I'm Reform or Conservative or Orthodox. And yet at the Kotel, for some reason, it's what? It's an Orthodox synagogue? What is the actual status of the Kotel? And then I'm just going to ask already my question to Chaya. Well, you know these people, these activists, and you maybe participated a little bit in what happens there. And you'll tell us a little bit about what that feels. And please, 2-3 minutes each, because, kashrut and conversion.
So the Kotel did not have a mechitza until after the Six Days War. We have pictures from the times of pre-state Palestine, and men and women were there with no partition in the middle. Due to internal Israeli politics, and I will not go into the details of the legal regulation, but formally the Kotel had become what's considered as a Beit Knesset, and the control over this Beit Knesset is given to a specific position who is the rabbi of the Kotel, and he's in charge, he's part of the holy places, and the regulation says that the religious practice there should be according to Minhag HaMakom, so the custom of the place. So what is the custom of the place? Of course, it's open to interpretation. But the traditional interpretation had been that it's the Orthodox way of worshiping, which of course means that there must be a partition between men and women, and women are not allowed to wear talitot, and God forbid a woman is not allowed to bring in a Sefer Torah to the women's part of the Kotel. Now, I think that we've all heard about the Battle of Women of the Wall. And I want to emphasize here that as far as I understand, the international attention and the awareness to their battle of the Women of the Wall had only become visible once the Reform and the Conservative movements, it occurred to them that their freedom of exercise rights are being violated every day in the place which is the most sacred to Jews all over the world, notwithstanding the fact that UNESCO, for some odd reason, denies it, but we know that it is the most sacred place for Jews all over the world, and 2/3 of the Jewish people cannot worship there according to their belief and their understanding
I have to interrupt you. This is a critical question, and I have to challenge you with this question. This is the question you hear from the rabbi of the Kotel, Rav Rabinovich, and I think from the Haredi public in Israel generally. I'm going to invent a new measure. It's called prayer hours. A single prayer hour is a person praying for 1 hour. I think the Haredim probably outnumber everyone else at the Kotel by prayer hours, 800-1.
So what?
So make the case that's not Minhag HaMakom, or significant, or what
since
should we deal with?
Since
how should
when
we?
Is this a measurement for a person's internal conviction, or a religious conviction, or religious identity? I'm not aware of any such measurement. And if I were to be cynical, I would ask, how come these men, and it's mostly men, how come they have so much time on their hands to be present so many hours over there? Now, what the Women of the Wall asked for, and a compromise that was almost reached years ago, was to have just 1 hour a month on the day of the Rosh Chodesh, because Rosh Chodesh is used to be a celebration of women in the Jewish tradition, to have 1 hour to be able to pray there with Talitot and read from the Sefer Torah, and even that could not pass.
Thank you. Chaya.
So maybe just to add a small thing, I think I shared with some people who is in the room, but one of the most crazy experience for me as Israeli in America was the first day I went to Hillel on Friday evening, and what happened is that you enter the building and you have one room dedicated for an Orthodox minyan. You go upstairs, there is conservative, and then reform, reconstructionist, and a secular one that literally sing Beatles for Kabbalat Shabbat. What really amazing is, and I was 25 at the time when I was there, that first of all, it was crazy for me that in the same building you can have five different minyanim, and the Orthodox minyan will be there and not gonna ask to expel the others. But it was really, really, really amazing that in the end of the tefillah, when everyone comes to cheder ochel, to the dining room, to eat Shabbat dinner, all the five people who led the minyanim, and it's Berkeley, right? So let's say none of them is woman or man, except the Orthodox. The five of them stood on the stage and say kiddush together. The be'emet for me, it was a moment that I said to myself, can never happen in Israel. Five people who led different minyanim can never lead the kiddush together, because in Israel, in all the streams, I think we have problems with that, like celebrate their Jewish identity on top of the others. And I really think the opposite case when it comes to Israel in today, I think in the American discourse in Jewish community, that it's really hard for them to come together around Israel, where in Israel it's a little bit different, because in each family you have five people that vote for five parties, so you must get along. But in America, I think really this is one of the challenges that the communities face today. But when it comes to Jewish expressions, like you can be Orthodox and I can be Reform, and we can both lead Minyanim and lead the Kiddush. And I think what I find out when I start going to this Tfilot Rosh Chodesh in the Kotel, first of all, we in Israel at the beginning, and I think the demonization that the politicians try to do to it, to say, this is the crazy Reform. So it's not an Israeli, because in Israel, the Reform community consider a small one and like not Jewish enough. And they say, this is a Reform activity. And once we came there, we find out it's not the case. And you saw women from literally different streams. Like we had conservative and Orthodox and Reform. And I think there was something there, really, in the female solidarity that really, really crossed this sectorial, let's say, discourse. And in that sense, that was amazing for me. I didn't come to the prayer because it's not what I was interested about. I was interested of being part of a female movement that says we can work together because we have oyev meshutaf. We have a common enemy. And I think that was, for me, a changing point in that discourse. And I don't know, maybe Ruth can speak more about that, but it happened only around the Kotel today, that really can women come together. And I think mostly the Orthodox women feel that for years, they need to be in the back of the synagogues, and that's it, no more. Like how the Canadian president say, we're in 2016, and he's right, we wanna be there, we wanna take part of it. And I think for me, that was really, really moving to be part of that.
Thank you. Hold on to the microphone, Chaya. I wanna move on to Kashrut. And no pressure. Kashrut is a situation similar to marriage and divorce, in the sense that, I don't know if you know, but the word kosher, the word kafshin resh, in Israeli law is reserved for the kosher when the state institution called rabbinate says it is kosher. So if I have an item that is kosher, but in fact the Israeli state rabbinate hasn't officially said it is kosher, I am not legally allowed to advertise it as kosher, even if it is actually kosher. And even if had the rabbinate looked, they would have decided it was kosher. Nevertheless, the word itself is a legally protected trademarked word. Not dissimilar to the question of marriage. You're very involved in this question of kashrut with Rabbi Leibovitz, who's also on the City Council of Jerusalem. Many people in the room might know him or of him. Are you a criminal, and are you escaping the law?
Yes. So maybe I share that 6 years ago when I was a student, I wrote a paper about kashrut. And I was very busy with the question, why places who are open on Shabbat cannot get a kashrut certificate? Because again, halachically, there is no problem. A place can be open on Shabbat. The kashrut is about the food. Nothing is happening on the day of Shabbat that makes the food less kosher. But again, when the Rabbanut say, you want that certificate, you must close on Shabbat, the secular people in Israel say, oh, probably this is what Judaism has to say about kashrut. Not true. So what we did is we wanted to create an alternative and to look for restaurants. We wanted to start with vegan, which is the easiest, and vegetarians, and to say to the restaurants, you can open on Shabbat and we're going to give you a kashrut certificate from Sunday to Friday. Again, the rabbi who did it with me, he is an American rabbi. Of course, and I'm saying this, you probably noticed, it's a pattern.
And he's from Berkeley.
And he's from Berkeley. Bichlal, Bichlal. but he's a man, yeah. So what we did is we said, let's do that. But we find out that in Jerusalem, it's really hard because in the end of the day, it's a business. It's not only an ideologic activism. The people in the restaurants, if people decide to skip their restaurant because it doesn't have kashrut certificate, they will lose money. So we said, okay, let's wait with Shabbat. And what we did, we went to restaurants who used to have a kashrut certificate and decided to take it away because they just didn't get along with the mashgiach. And according to the Rabbanut, no woman can be mashgichot, supervisors in the restaurant, because they are women. And it was amazing because I was sitting in a panel with like the chief rabbi of Jerusalem. And I said to him, really, I didn't try to be cynical, but like, I was raised, I'm like, you need to be in the kitchen. So how come when it comes to the kitchen positions, I can't be there? And he said something really, really interesting, that once I go to a restaurant and I said to the person who owned the place, you didn't separate as you should have between this and that, I become a rabbi. I become a halachic decider. And this is something we can't have. So in Israel, there is no woman who works as supervisors. And we said, let's create an organization that gives a halachic kashrut certificate. Only women will be the supervisors, as at the beginning at least. And let's have, like, and the system should not be corruptive. Because in Israel, you can ask restaurants how much you pay for the supervisor. He will say 400 shekel. How come? Oh, my cousin knows the cousin of the person who do it. And you go to the same size of kitchen in the other side of the street, and they pay 800 shekel. And this is really the case. So we said, let's take the same amount of money from everyone. The places are still closed on Shabbat, but let's create an alternative. So we started 6 years ago with two restaurants. Today we have 27. It's not that a big like growth, but it's become like crazy. Taitona, you're a journalist. According to the interviews we had in the media, it seems like we had thousands of restaurants. Always when in the end they said, so how many restaurants do you have? We're like 27. Because it was a sensation. And the reason why it was a sensation, that the Rabbanut was terrified because we touched her pocket. When it comes to marriage, whatever, you decide to marry or not. But the kashrut, it's there is a system.
Let me just add, we've had interviews. Shas just tried to tighten up this law,
right.
I think succeeded in the last Knesset,
to
tighten up this law. On people were saying, people were putting up notices that were saying, they couldn't use the word kosher, but they were saying, this place is under supervision. No, you're using the word kosher. So now you're no longer allowed to even hint that there might be any kind of kosher food in this place unless the rabbinate gives you a certificate, according to a law passed in the last session of the Knesset. And we interviewed some people from Hotels Association. Israel is a multi-billion, the tourism industry is a multi-billion shekel industry every year. And they are aware and hopeful that the kashrut market, the kashrut supervision market, is cracked open by what you're doing and by imports from overseas somehow being taken out of the hands of the rabbinate, and then they can start having, you know, New York rabbis doing hechsher and things like that. So they're very hopeful. So this is a more serious thing than activism in Central Jerusalem.
And we call it hashgacha pratit, which is funny in Hebrew, private hashgacha. And because at the beginning we called kashrut kilatit, but they sue us in the Supreme Court for using the word kashrut. And I will say that what happened a few months ago is unfortunate, because the decision of the court is that we can't longer to present our toda. can I just talk in Hebrew? It will be easier. We cannot present it because it's against the law. And what we did in all the places, just took the certificate and flipped it and wrote, the Rabbanut doesn't allow us to show you what is in the other side. And we did a whole campaign with it. And what happened is, as a result of it, that we got many, many more restaurants who want to join this. And I think it's, so we now expand outside of Jerusalem. We have in Tel Aviv and Be'er Sheva. We're now starting in Be'er Sheva. And what we are planning to do is to open a branch, hopefully in the next few months, that will give the same certificate for places who are open on Shabbat. So we're not going to do it with the branding of Hashgacha Pratit. It's going to be like a separate branch. And hopefully this will be more and more.
Professor Kaddari, I want to challenge you, because you're a professor of law, so we get to challenge you about everything. Member of Knesset Moshe Gafni of the United Torah Judaism Party insists that this is not about religious control. This is about consumer protection.
I want to say first something about the law here, because I think first of all, I think it's totally admirable what you personally have done and this whole movement, and it's again another example of challenges that can come from within. Knowing so well the discourse, the real halacha, if there is such a concept as real halacha, but being able to differentiate between politics and between what the text requires, can only come from people who are versed, who really know, who speak the language, and who understand. But you mentioned the decision of the High Court of Justice, and I think it's a demonstration of where the law sometimes fails us, and the role of the Supreme Court or the High Court of Justice in all this various reflections of the interconnection and the intertwined and opposite of separation of religion and state, the role of the Supreme Court is very, very idiosyncratic here and inconsistent. If it comes to the women of the wall, we can see how they prolonged and prolonged and prolonged the decision, and eventually they came to their help, and it didn't help. Now they failed. They failed this challenge. In my humble opinion, they were completely wrong. They are actually going to revisit the decision.
What could they have done differently? And they just said, this is the letter of the law. I who eat not in kosher or whatever secular judge, although many of them are religious themselves. This is the letter of the law. I don't change law. Knesset changes law. And this, see, in all honesty, what was wrong? But we know
that there is such a vast option of opinions, and you have majority and you have minority. Whenever you have a majority and minority, you know that it could have been decided otherwise. You in the U.S. know it much, much better than we do, right? We're all so scared of this upcoming nomination that may change from 5-4 in one direction to 5-4 in the opposite direction, and this could be legitimate outcomes of the legal question, but I think that the bottom line is that we really cannot count on the current Supreme Court of Israel, and it would probably become less and less place of where we could resort to. We are trying to challenge it all the time. You also mentioned the inability of women to serve in these positions such as Kashrut Mashgichot, or one appeal that the Rackman Center is now appealing to the High Court of Justice is to have a woman as a legal aid to rabbinical court deciders, to dayanim in the rabbinical courts. One thing that we take for granted, and it looks like it's the natural order of things, is that we have a whole judiciary system within Israel where women are excluded from. Women cannot be judges in the rabbinical courts, or in the Sharia courts, or in the Christian ecclesiastical courts. And it's unbelievable, right? 2020. Democracy in the Western world, and women cannot be judges in the area which affects mostly women and men in their personal lives. So we just challenge the fact that maybe a woman can be an assistant to the rabbinical court judge, and we still wait for the outcome of this case. But I'm really not optimistic about the way that the Supreme Court can help us. It's a work that has to be done from the bottom up, with sometimes like-minded politicians who may step forward and challenge the situation, but that will happen only when public opinion also changes. And this is where your work can also step in to help influence the public opinion, to put force on politicians who care about the Jewish world outside of Israel. Many Israelis tend to be very, very ethnocentric in the sense that the Jewish world is only Israel, and who cares about Jews who do not live in Israel? And unfortunately, it is a position that many Israelis still maintain. But it's your role, together with others in Israel, to change this view and understand that we are part of a community that is much, much larger than the geographical place where which Israel stands in, and everything that we discussed today, and we still may discuss the issue of conversion, which is probably the number one issue that affects you. Everything that we discuss here is shared by the Jewish people all over the world. So it's not just the question of Israelis to change the situation and to fight to change this situation. It's the responsibility of all of us.
Conversion. I want to touch one sentence, Chaya, about mikvaot and before that, a question to Ruth. Conversions is a place where you see the system fail to act. The Supreme Court of Israel, much maligned by the Israeli right as too powerful and too this and too that, and arguably it is the most powerful court in the Western world because it is the two institutions. It's also a court of equity called the High Court of Justice. Long story short, it's a fascinating separate panel in which I would love to hear your opinion. But in fact, the Israeli High Court of Justice for 10 years in the 90s refused to rule about whether reform conversions in America and conservative conversions in America are eligible for the law of return. Refused. There's no explicit Israeli law. The law of return has to either give it to you or not give it to you, so we have to know for the law whether you're Jewish or not. And the Knesset refused to just say, and the court for 10 years declined to do so. And lawsuit after lawsuit and appeal after appeal, eventually the court said this is not a lacuna that can continue to exist. People who might have full rights to citizenship in Israel, but because the Knesset literally can't get around to answering the question that's being asked, for decades not be able to find out if they're allowed to be Israeli. And so the court ruled, and it ruled that for the purposes of citizenship, even if not at the rabbinate, reform and conservative conversions. Now, that is not the story of the Supreme Court deciding that reformim are Jews. That's the story of the Supreme Court stepping into a legal lacuna where the Knesset couldn't get its act together. Is that the story? The Knesset just can't make decisions? 300,000 Israelis can't marry each other. I heard Rav Amar, the former chief rabbi of Israel and now the chief rabbi of Jerusalem, say, I can't solve it because I'm afraid to open doors to other things that will slip in if I open. But of course, 300,000 non-Jews should be able to marry each other. What do I care?
So it's exactly as you said. When the Supreme Court ruled that non-Orthodox conversions out of Israel should be recognized for the purposes of the law of return and for citizenship, they didn't actually say that reform conversion or conservative conversion is making a non-Jew become a Jew. It's not answering the question of who is a Jew, because the question of who is a Jew has its implications with respect to the possibility of the subject that we started with, the subject of are they eligible to marry other Jews. The fact that you can be registered as Jew in your ID in Israel and can get this whole package of a Jew entering Israel under the law of return does not mean that you can actually marry a Jew in Israel. These are two separate issues which are very difficult to explain to non-Jewish or non-Israeli people. And they just ruled this year that those non-Orthodox conversions in Israel also are eligible for the law of return and for citizenship, but not for the questions of marriage and divorce.
And why can't the Knesset make these decisions?
Because they are afraid that they will undermine, that's what they say, that they will undermine the nature of the Jewish state and that they will create a schism within the Jewish people in the Jewish state. That's what they argue that's what they use. It's like it's actually it's a straw man argument. It's really it doesn't hold water, but they know that they will lose their constituency if they dare do step forward and say that the rules on rules of conversion should be different and should be more inclusive and should accord the same recognition to non-Orthodox streams of Judaism. It's probably not going to change. Under the current Israeli politics and the way that things seem in the future, this is really not going to change. The only way that it could change is, again, from those who are undermining Orthodoxy from within, and it could be happening because the ultra-Orthodox are being so threatened now that they even reach this situation where they... cancel or they do not recognize, thank you, conversions by Orthodox rabbis in the United States. The conversions of Rabbi Lukshtin, who happens to be the rabbi of the Trumps, as I just heard, his conversions, I mean, one of the most esteemed Orthodox rabbis in New York City, or the conversions of another ultra-Orthodox rabbi whose name now skips me, not Avi Weiss. Avi Weiss was controversial before. Rav Gedalia Schwartz, thank you, who's really beyond any controversy. His conversions are not recognized by the Rabbanut Rashid, by the rabbinical formal rabbinical courts in Israel, which is completely absurd. So I think that they reach that extreme, it's going to blow up in their face.
So it's a sign of them feeling under threat. They can't sustain.
Yeah.
So Chaya, tell us about Mikvaot is very much part of this.
Yeah.
There was a victory, or was there?
Well, I think it was, and I think I'm wrong. But I will say that as part of being converted, you must, like in the end, the last stage is going to dive in a mikveh. For many, many years, like the reform movement, I think this is the one who tried to say that the conservatives, Slicha movement, said we want to be able in that final stage of conversion to go in and to do the ceremony in the public mikvaot that exist in Israel. And of course, the mikvaot, as anything else in the public domain, must be Orthodox. So the mikvaot places didn't allow those rabbis to come and do that final stage. Not at the same time, but in the past, let's say, 3 years, there is a growing group of women who say something different, who say, when I'm going to dive in the mikveh, I'm not interested that the balanit, the woman who is supervising that space, first ask me questions. Most of the questions are you married or not? And if you are not married, many of them are not allowed the woman to come in. And again, requiring the woman to do things that are not halachic, again, that are more traditional and things like that. And the women, starting with a big group of Orthodox women who say, we don't need halachity to have a balanit there, we want to go to the mikveh and to do it ourselves. What interesting is that there is a phenomenon that started is like that in the, let's say, past decade, you have more and more women that are not married for many different reasons. I have a few friends from Harnov who never got married. One of them is lesbian, two of them are just didn't find someone to marry with, and they're all Orthodox. And they got to a point that they say, I'm having relationship with someone, and I want to do it according to the halacha. I want to go and dive in the mikveh, but I'm not married. And the balaniot, the person who owned that space, didn't allow them to come. And they said, enough. We want to make sure that the mikvaot is free for us to go, and we don't need to be supervised. What happened is, and I think it's unfortunate, that Gafni from the Shas party decided to connect between those two Mavakim, issues. And what he said is, politically, he said, let's all agree that the public mikvaot must be Orthodox, meaning conservative and reform cannot bring their converted to that mikvaot. And the treat I will give you will be that for a woman who wants to come and dive, you don't have to have a balanit. I'm summarizing it. It's more complex. What happened was that was a big, big debate over it because many Knesset member, feminist Knesset member, voted for that. And by doing it, actually, they placed, again, the reform and conservative as the outsiders, and they allow women to go and dive as they want. So Anat and I were arguing over it because I think it's a small victory. And for me, it's true. I understand someone who is reform or conservative who feels, again, he was pushed aside. But I think, really, and this is what I'm saying about kashrut, I don't care about kashrut, but I do think that when you succeed in להגביל את הרבנות, when you limiting the power of the rabbanut, this will lead into a situation, Be'ezrat Hashem, that we will be able to create alternatives to the rabbanut. So for me, I think it's a small victory, maybe also as a woman who interested to go to the mikveh without having a balanit there. But I think, and I'm saying this to my sisters from the other movements, I think once you did it, because the rabbanut was angry about it, about us taking the balanit out, but once we did it, I think the potential from now to create more change in that field is bigger.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to turn to questions. Can I ask for people to line up in front of the microphones? We're going to take several questions in a row. I will write them down, and then Chaya and Ruth will answer.
Thank you. Alan Brandt, Jewish Colorado, I want to thank you for your presentation. I think it's subjects that have to be presented more broadly across the United States. My question to you is that at a session yesterday, I heard the statistic that Haredi women were getting into the workplace by greater percentage than in the past. What effect is that having on your programs of Haredi women getting involved in this system of improvement?
Hello, my name is Lipaz, and I'm a Jewish Agency Israel Fellow to Hillel at UCLA. If you don't know what the Israel Fellows are, you can come to our cafe, we're wearing green, and ask us. Thank you so much, you were such an inspiration for me. And I was wondering, working with college students and the next generation of American Jewry, I have a true concern of those students actually born into a world that Israel is taking for granted, and when they're seeing the Israel that we talked about here, they're saying, this is not the Israel that is inclusive for us and for our Judaism, and taking a step back from Israel because of all the things that are happening. So they are actually wondering, maybe we shouldn't have a Jewish state, because if Israel is not a state for all Jews, it shouldn't be a part of our identity. I was wondering, what do you think about it? And how do we change reality in Israel? Because as an Israeli, first time I've encountered Reformed or Conservative Jews was here in this Shlichut for the first time. So just was wondering your thoughts. Thank you again.
How did you manage to not meet Reformed Jews with that English?
See, that's our problem. That's what we need to change in Israel and in the Jewish diaspora at all.
Suzy Gelman again, and Toda Rabah. This has been fabulous. And next year in Los Angeles, I hope this is a plenary. That's how important this issue is. I have a question. I think it's primarily for Ruth, but Chaya, please chime in. This has been bothering me for a long time, and I don't understand it, especially when we talk about divorce in Israel. I don't understand why 50% of the population, women, tolerates the situation, tolerates the discrimination, tolerates the fact that they are not people when it comes to the Batei Din. Maybe Haredi women wouldn't rise up in the same numbers, although it sounds like Haredi women are finding their voice. But if enough Israeli women just stood up and said, Ad Kan, I won't take it anymore, you would have a change. So why are Israeli women not doing that? Thank you.
My name is Or, and I'm the Jewish Agency Israel Fellow for Northeastern in Boston. I'm 27 years old, and I was raised up as traditional. And as Lipaz said, I never heard of Reform and Conservative Judaism in my life, and apparently I'm living 10 minutes away from the biggest Reform movement in Israel, near Haifa. And since I got here, I really not only gained like another Israel perspective, but I won and gained a new Jewish identity, a rich, diverse, creative, and amazing Jewish identity that I will bring back, hopefully, to Israel. My question is, there is so many collaborations between Jewish communities and cities around Israel and North America, like sister cities, and there is like so many projects that happens, and the U.S. is always been supported when it comes to the political arena and BDS, and I was wondering if you have any suggestion, how can we bring a more Jewish education to Israel, but not only for the Israelis that choose to do major in Jewish studies, but the one that actually does not have any Jewish identity at all. And I just wanted one thing. We have to like also talk and mention about the complexity of Israel, that so many people came from different countries. My grandparents came from Morocco, and the only Judaism they know is the Orthodox Judaism. And I feel that, one more thing, that we also should respect this field as well and respect Orthodox Jews, because they believe in something. And the fact that we want an alternative, it doesn't mean we don't need to respect them, but I'm thinking about my generation that does not, mostly of us, that does not really have any connection to our Jewish identity. How can we change it from the society? Thank you.
Those are phenomenal questions, but they were long ones. Please, just short.
I will make it brief. My name is Jocelyn Grifter. I am from Potomac, Maryland. I go to a modern Orthodox synagogue. Our rabbi is from Chovave, not recognized by the Orthodox Union. There is a group of rabbis from Chovave and others from the modern Orthodox community who will not marry a couple now unless the man has signed a prenup. It's not a Brad and Angelina prenup. It's a prenup that says that the man from the get-go will give his wife a get, regardless of the circumstances. And I was wondering if that is something, not to be so presumptuous as to assume that I'm going to change the laws in Israel, but that's something that from the grassroots level, from the perspective of the rabbis, they could start insisting that the man signs a prenup like that, and maybe that movement can rise from the bottom up.
Hi, I'm Robin Batya Friedman from Edmonton, Canada. You opened up the panel with separation of church and state. You brought examples of solutions to the states. Is it so crazy to have Israel as a separation of church and state? Maybe that's a solution, and why not?
Okay, we're gonna do this lightning round style. You ready? You literally have a sentence in response. Mr. Brandt, Haredi women working, are they going into politics? One sentence. It could be a run-on sentence with a lot of commas.
I must say that the only thing that I think Bibi did well to Israel, the only thing, is when he was a treasurer, treasurer minister.
Finance minister.
He cut the funds. He cut the funds from families that used to get a lot of funds from the state when they had many children. And that was a changing point within the Haredi community, that then the Haredi woman needed not only to work within the community, but to go outside to the market. And I think it's an excellent question, because that's what I think. I think there is also changes within the Haredi community. It's mostly based on Haredi women who go outside of the community, not teachers in the community, exposed to foreign ideas of liberalism and equality, and they come back as a change agent. I will say, really short thing, that we had one collaboration in Jerusalem between Haredi and non-Haredi women, and it was around the issue that every year during Sukkot in Mea Shearim, the Haredi neighborhood, the Haredi put signs on the midrachot, the signing walk, and say, women and men. And the most annoying part is that the woman must go, they build like a construction of like a mechila.
Like a tunnel?
Like a tunnel to the woman to walk, so the men won't see them. And we went to the Supreme Court and we said, excuse me, this is a street in Israel. You can't say women go here and men go there. And what happened was amazing. We started getting phone calls from women, from Mispar Chasui, like you couldn't see the number, literally whispering and saying thank you and how can we help? And this was one of the projects that we tried to tell them, how can you help? Help us from within. And I think, again, the issues related to women and solidarity are the issues that we are trying now to bridge, on, especially in Jerusalem.
Ultra-Orthodox women entering politics is a huge subject. They are, again, they're being blocked by their male counterparts. We are now in the midst of challenging this in front of the Supreme Court. We actually got, unexpectedly, an injunction that orders the state to come and explain why the Takanon, the internal regulation of the ultra-Orthodox parties that actually say that only men can be members of that party. Women cannot be official members of Shas or of Yadut HaTorah. This is a legal political regulation in Israel, and we're challenging this now in front of the Supreme Court. We are hopeful there, but it's a very, very difficult battle.
Mishpat, mamash aval shtemim.
In Al-Ad, which is a Haredi community, the first time that a woman tried to run into the local municipality, and they break it. And what they did is that they ran with a party that without female advertisement, but also they named their party Family Party. They couldn't name it like the female party, and they won many seats. They didn't get passed to the municipality, but this was a beginning.
Is Israel telling U.S. Jews that it's not theirs? Is Israel telling American Jews or diaspora Jews that it doesn't belong to them?
I think that in a way you could read it that way. I think it's very, very, very sad, and I think that that's why we need to have this panel and maybe next year a plenary, and the federations should definitely not give up, because giving up would mean giving up on Israel. That goes to your question. So it's our responsibility, all of us, to change the rules of the game. And it has to do with religion and state, and with politics and religion and state, and with the super control that Orthodoxy and Orthodoxy in general has on the resources. The fact that you were not familiar with any of the non-Orthodox ways of Jewish life in Israel is because of the control over the resources. It's a question of money. A dirty word, but it gets to that.
I'm going to express an opinion. No, it's not telling American Jews that. Israel is a society. It's a civilization. We have 2 million school children. We have 80 cities. And we're going to say all kinds of things all at once. And people who think that we're talking to them in their own little moral narrative and don't think that we are an entire complicated, contradictory society don't really see us. And so if I may be mean about it, it's your responsibility to see Israel as three-dimensional human beings. And yes, occasionally it's going to be say mean things to you, and I think that is fair. But don't, you know, I don't think it's then fair to say, it's like America is saying things to the world. America doesn't even tell itself any coherent things. Divorce. Why do women tolerate the divorce situation in Israel? And let me just challenge you, please, don't tell us why they should not tolerate it. Diagnostically, why are they actually tolerating it?
It's a million dollar question. I wish I knew the answer to that. 25 years now, I'm working on this, and I still do not know the answer. I can start giving you many explanations going through feminist theories and connecting this to the whole question of divorce in other society, in other places. It's the awful experience that a woman can go through, whether in Israel or out of Israel. Women who go through that do not want to recollect this afterwards. They want to get away from that. They want to forget about it. So it's not going to be the number one issue for which they're going to battle. Most divorcees do not have the means, the luxury of the time to give to engage in such a battle and to become activists. They have to raise the children, and they don't have money to do that because they're getting less and less money, less and less child support. We hadn't talked about all these issues at all. So there are many, many isolated, practical, pragmatic reasons for that, and yet the overall big reason, I don't know it. I'm there. I'm not losing hope. Even though it's an uphill battle, and it's very often one step forward, two steps backwards, we still hope that we can do something about
it. Can a halachic prenup come to Israel? And the really easy question from Margaret, was it? From Canada?
Separation.
Yeah. Thank you. Can Israel do a separation of church and state?
Can't do it in two sentences. Prenups, the current prenups that do exist in Israel are very, very important, but they are not going to solve the problem because they still give the power to the rabbinical court to actually determine whether to employ it or not. We are trying to work on a prenup. Actually, we have a prenup, but that does give the solution for that in terms of actually retroactively invalidating the betrothal, the actual betrothal. But to be frank, it's not going to be recognized by any recognized rabbinical court in Israel. It is very important in order to raise awareness and to educate. So okay. In that sense, we're trying to promote
Chaya, and then I'm going to have one last word. I swear,
Orthodox
one word.
An Orthodox rabbi named Malka Piotrkovsky in Israel, one of the things that she's trying to promote, and hopefully it will happen, is to add to the ketubah one sentence that said that if the husband, or one of the tzedim, don't have time to translate, understand what you
do.
Decide not to give the get to his wife. He have 18 months to do it, and after 8 months, the court has the power
to annul
the marriage, Or another thing is to say, for each day that you refuse to give the get, you must pay.
But
they want to put it as part of the ketubah.
In the end, the rabbis have to be in on it.
Nachon.
Yeah.
I don't agree. I think it's using, again, the Orthodox system to change it from within.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we tried to make life... One second. We tried to make life very complicated, but I hope that you got from this complexity 1,000 different ways to step in. There are 1,000 places. If you don't know exactly how, I know 2 people who can help you with that. And thank you very much. Enjoy yourselves. And if you want someone to represent the ultra-Orthodox perspective, the Times of Israel publish op-eds. So come on in.
We would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support JBS, the Jewish Broadcasting Service, with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai, or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the JBS homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to GEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.